B, section 0.5% consistent with the section 4.3 of the FRBM Act, both for RE 2019-20 and BE 2020-21. Accordingly, the return path is being laid before the Parliament as a medium term, as a part of the medium term fiscal policy come strategy statement. This fiscal path commits us to the path of fiscal consolidation without compromising the needs of investment out of public funds. Accordingly, net market borrowings for the year 2019-20 would be 4.99 lakh crore, and for the year 2020-21 it would be 5.36 lakh crores. A good part, this is very important, sir, a good part of the borrowings of the financial year 2020-21 would go towards capital expenditure of the government that has been scaled up by more than 21%. As I had previously mentioned, another about 22,000 crores have already been allocated for equity to fund certain specified infrastructure finance companies who would leverage it manifold and provide much needed long-term finance for infrastructure sector. That should spur the growth impulses in the economy. So I would now move to part B of my speech. Direct tax. Sir, part B of my speech starts with direct tax, sir. Honorable Speaker, sir, our government has spearheaded radical fiscal measures to ensure that Indian economy continues to tread the path of high growth. There are times when countries are competing with each other like never before to become the most attractive destination for doing business. Therefore, to make sure that India stays globally competitive and a favored destination for investment, we took a bold historic decision of reducing the corporate tax rate for new companies in the manufacturing sector to an unprecedented level of 15%. Similarly, for the existing companies, the rate has also been brought down to 22%, which is the lowest in the world now. This will enable companies to expand their businesses and make fresh investments in the coming future. Though we will have loss of substantial revenue due to these measures in the short run, I'm certain that our economy will reap huge returns on this score in due course. So one quick verse from Raghuvamsa, written by Kalidasa. Prajanam eva bhutyartham sattabhyo balim agrahit. Prajanam eva bhutyartham sattabhyo balim agrahit. Sahasra gunam utsrashtam adatte hi rasam ravihi. Surya, the sun, collects vapor from little drops of water. He collects only from little drops of water. So does the king. They give back copiously. They collect these from the people only for their well-being. So the collection of taxes or the vapor from the water drops are only from small trickles, but they all go back to the people manifold. So the purpose of taxation and also the way in which it is done has been voiced even then. And this in Raghuvamsa refers to the Purvaja or the elders belonging to Ikshvaku dynasty, father of Ayodhya Pati Rama, Dilipa, grandfather. It refers to Dilipa, the king. So in continuation of the reform measures already taken so far, the tax proposals in this budget will introduce further reforms to stimulate growth, simplify tax structure, bring ease of compliance and reduce litigation, personal income tax and simplification of taxation. So in the interim budget of 2019, our government exempted individuals having income up to 5 lakh of rupees from paying any income tax. Presently, an individual pays 20% on income between 5 lakh and 10 lakh and 30% on income between 10 lakh. That's the prevailing matrix. Further, currently the Income Tax Act is riddled with various exemptions and deductions which make compliance by the taxpayer and administration of Income Tax Act by the tax authorities a burdensome process. It is almost impossible for a taxpayer to comply with income tax law without taking the help from professionals. In order to provide significant relief to the individual taxpayers and to simplify the income tax law, I propose to bring a new simplified personal income tax regime wherein income tax rates will be significantly reduced for the individual taxpayers who forego certain deductions and exemptions. Under the new regime, sir, an individual shall be required to pay tax at the reduced rate of 10% for income between 5 lakhs to 7.5 lakhs against the prevailing 20%. So anyone who's earning between 5 to 7.5 lakhs, sir, today pays 20%. We are now reducing it in the new regime, which is devoid of exemptions, to 10% only. So 20% comes down to 10%. Sir, the next example. For income between 7.5 lakhs to 10 lakhs, I earlier said about 5 to 7.5, now I'm saying about 7.5 to 10 lakhs. So for income between 7.5 lakh to 10 lakh, he or she will pay at the reduced rate of 15% only against the current prevailing 20%. Sir, similarly, for the income between 10 lakhs to 12.5 lakhs, presently the tax is 30%. For income between 10 lakh to 12.5 lakh, the present prevailing rate is 30%. That is now being brought down to 20% only. Sir, the income between, I spoke about 10 to 12.5 lakhs. Now, 12.5 lakhs to 15 lakhs will be taxed. At the moment, 12.5 to 15 lakhs is taxed at 30%. Now, those earning between 12.5 lakhs to 15 lakhs will be charged at 25% only. Sir, incomes above 15 lakhs will be continued at 30%, but no exemptions at all. Those earning up to 5 lakhs shall not pay any tax either in the old regime or in the new regime. So the proposed tax structure will provide significant relief to taxpayers and more so to those in the middle class. I just want to very clearly read out 0 to 2.5 lakh exempt now, will be exempt in the new scheme also. 2.5 lakhs to 5 lakhs, 5% now will be 5% in the new tax rate. 5 to 7.5 lakhs, 20% now will become 10% in the new rate. 7.5 to 10 lakhs, 20% now will be 15% in the new. 10 to 12.5 lakhs, 30% now will now come to 20%. 12.5 to 15 lakhs, 30% now, 25% in the new rate. Above 15 continues at 30%. In the new tax regime, sir, substantial tax benefit will accrue to a taxpayer depending upon the exemptions and deductions claimed by him. For example, just to make it clear, for example, a person earning 15 lakh of rupees in a year and not availing any deductions whatsoever will pay 1,95,000 as compared to 2,73,000 that is paying now in the old regime. So this, his tax burden shall be reduced by 78,000 rupees. That will be the reduction in the tax that he has to otherwise pay. Then this is the example of somebody who earns 15 lakhs. He would still be a gainer. He would still be a gainer in the new regime, even if he was taking deduction of 1.5 lakh under various sections of Chapter 6A of the Income Tax Act under the old regime. The new tax regime, sir, shall be optional for taxpayers. So there's no compulsion. Those who want to be in the old regime can continue to be in the old regime, in the old rates, in the whole sets of exemptions and deductions. But those who wish to come into the new are welcome to come into the new. An individual who is currently availing more deductions and exemptions under the Income Tax Act may choose to avail them and continue to pay the tax in the old regime. A new personal tax income tax rate will entail estimated revenue foregone of 40,000 crores per year. We have also initiated measures to pre-fill income tax return so that an individual who opts for the new regime would need no assistance from an expert to file his return and pay income tax. Sir, I will have to put this observation here. In order to simplify income tax system, I have reviewed all the exemptions and deductions which got incorporated in the income tax legislation over the past several decades. In fact, I have that list with me, sir. I have reviewed all the exemptions and deductions which got incorporated in the income tax legislation over the past several decades. It was surprising to know that currently more than 100 exemptions and deductions of different nature are provided in the Income Tax Act. No wonder the code is like this, the book. I have removed around 70 of them. I have removed around 70 of them in the new simplified regime. We will review and rationalize the remaining exemptions and deductions in the coming years with a view to further simplifying the tax system and lowering tax rates. Sir, the dividend distribution tax. Currently, companies are required to pay dividend distribution tax on the dividend paid to its shareholders at the rate of 15% plus applicable surcharge and cess in addition to the tax payable by the company on its profits. It has been argued that the system of levying DDT results in increase in tax burden for investors and especially those who are liable to pay tax less than the rate of DDT if the dividend income is included in their income. Further, non-availability of credit of DDT to most of the foreign investors in their home country results in reduction of rate of return on equity capital for them. In order to increase the attractiveness of the Indian equity market and to provide relief to a large class of investors, I propose to remove the DDT and adopt the classical system of dividend distribution tax, under which companies would not be required to pay DDT. The dividend shall be taxed only in the hands of the recipients at their applicable rates. Further, in order to remove the cascading effect, I also propose to allow deduction for the dividend received by holding company from its subsidiary. The removal of DDT will lead to estimated annual revenue foregone of 25,000 crores. This is another bold move, sir, which will further make India an attractive destination for investment. sir, concessional rate for electricity generation companies. In order to give boost to the manufacturing sector, a new provisions were introduced in September 2019, offering a concessional corporate tax rate of 15% to the newly incorporated domestic companies in the manufacturing sector, which start manufacturing by March 31, 2023, the corporate rate cut, which happened in September. In order to attract investment in power sector, I propose to extend the concessional corporate tax rate cut to down to 15% to new domestic companies engaged in the generation of electricity as well, so that corporate rate, which came down to 15% for the new manufacturing companies, will now be available even for power generation companies too. So tax concession for foreign investments. In order to incentivize the investment by foreign sovereign wealth funds of foreign governments in the priority sector, I propose to grant 100% tax exemption to their interest, dividend and capital gains income in respect of investment made in infrastructure and other notified sectors before 31st March 2024 with a minimum lock-in period of 3 years. Honorable Speaker, sir, in order to make available foreign funds at lower cost, I propose to extend the period of concessional withholding rate of 5% under Section 194LC for interest payment to non-residents in respect of monies borrowed and bonds issued up to 30th June 2023. I also propose to extend the period up to 30th June 2023 for lower rate of withholding of 5% under Section 194LD for interest payment to foreign portfolio investors and qualified foreign investors in respect of bonds issued by Indian companies and government securities. I further propose to extend the concessional rate of withholding of 5% under Section 194LD to the interest payment made on the municipal bonds. In order to incentivize listing of bonds at IFSC exchange, I propose to further reduce the withholding rate from 5% to 4% on interest payment on the bonds listed on its exchanges. Startups have emerged as an engine of growth for our economy. Over the past year, our government has taken several measures to handhold them and support their growth. During their formative years, startups generally use Employee Stock Option Plan, the ESOP, to attract and retain highly talented employees. ESOP is a significant component of compensation for these employees. Currently, ESOPs are taxable as perquisites at the time of exercise. This leads to cash flow problem for the employees who do not sell the shares immediately and continue to hold the same for long term. In order to give a boost to the startup ecosystem, I propose to ease the burden of taxation on the employees by deferring the tax payment by 5 years or till they leave the company or when they sell their shares, whichever is earliest. Further, an eligible startup having turnover of up to 25 crores is allowed a deduction of 100% of its profits for 3 consecutive assessment years out of 7 years. If the total turnover does not exceed 25 crore rupees, in order to extend this benefit to larger startups also, I propose to increase the turnover limit from existing 25 crores to 100 crores. Moreover, considering the fact that in the initial years, a startup may not have adequate profit to avail this deduction, I propose to extend the period of eligibility for claim of deduction from the existing 7 years to 10 years. So the corporate rate cut in September has led to a lot of cooperatives who are asking for level playing field. Cooperative societies play an extremely important role in our economy, in facilitating access to credit, procurement of inputs, and marketing of products to their members. These cooperatives are currently taxed at the rate of 30% with surcharge and cess. As a major concession, and in order to bring parity between cooperative societies and corporates, I propose to provide an option to the cooperative societies to be taxed at 22% plus 10% surcharge and 4% cess with no exemption or deductions. Further, I also propose to exempt these cooperative societies from alternative minimum tax, the AMT, just like companies under the new tax regime are exempted from minimum alternative tax, the MAT. MAT for corporate tax, corporates were removed, and similarly now, AMT for the cooperatives is also being removed. Medium and small and micro enterprises, the MSMEs, currently businesses having turnover of more than 1 crore rupees are required to get their books of accounts audited by an accountant. In order to reduce the compliance burden on small retailers, traders, shopkeepers who comprise the MSME sector, I propose to raise by 5 times the turnover threshold for audit from the existing 1 crore to 5 crore. So up to 5 crore, there wouldn't be a requirement for auditing of their accounts. Further, in order to boost less cash economy, I propose that the increased limit shall apply only to those businesses which carry out less than 5% of their businesses and business transactions in cash. So we wish to move to greater digitization. Affordable housing. For realization of the goal of housing for all and affordable housing, in the last budget, I had announced an additional deduction of up to 1,50,000 rupees for interest paid on loans taken for the purchase of an affordable house. The deduction was allowed on housing loans sanctioned on or before 31st March 2020. In order to ensure that more persons avail this benefit and to further incentivize the affordable housing, I propose to extend the date of loan sanction for availing this additional deduction by 1 more year. Further, in order to boost the supply of affordable houses in the country, a tax holiday is provided on the profits earned by developers of affordable housing projects approved by 31st March 2020. In order to promote the affordable housing projects, I propose to extend the date of approval of affordable housing projects for availing the tax holiday by 1 more year again. I propose to extend the date of approval of affordable housing projects for availing this tax holiday by 1 more year. So next is the concession to real estate transactions. Currently, while taxing income from capital gains, business profits, and other sources in respect of transactions in real estate, if the consideration value is less than the circle rate by more than 5%, the difference is counted as income both in the hands of the purchaser and the seller. In order to minimize hardship in the real estate transaction and provide relief to the sector, I propose to increase the limit from 5% to 10%. Charity institutions. Acknowledging the important role played by the charitable institutions in the society, the income of these institutions is fully exempt from taxation. Further, donations made to these institutions are also allowed as deduction in computing taxable income of the donor. Currently, a taxpayer is required to fill the complete details of this in the donation done in the income tax return for availing deduction. In order to ease the process of claiming deduction for donation, it is proposed to pre-fill the donee's information in taxpayer's return on the basis of information of donations furnished by the donee. This would result in hassle-free claim of deduction for the donation made by the taxpayer. Further, in order to claim the tax exemption, the charity institution had to be registered with the income tax department. In the past, the process of the registration was completely manual and scattered all over the country. In order to simplify the compliance for the new and existing charity institutions, I propose to make the process of registration completely electronic, under which a unique registration number shall be issued to all new and existing charity institutions. To facilitate the registration of the new charity institution, which is yet to start their charitable activities, I propose to allow them provisional registration of 3 years. Faceless appeals. Our government is committed to bringing in transformational changes so that maximum governance is provided with minimum government. In order to impart greater efficiency, transparency, and accountability to the assessment process, a new faceless assessment scheme has already been introduced. Currently, most of the functions of the income tax department, starting from the filing of return, processing of returns, issuance of refunds, and assessment, are performed in the electronic mode without any human interface. In order to take the reforms initiated by the department to the next level and to eliminate human interface, I propose to amend the Income Tax Act so as to enable faceless appeal on the lines of faceless assessment. So faceless assessment was done, now faceless appeals will also be possible. Sir, Honorable Speaker, Vivad Se Vishwas scheme. Vivad Se Vishwas scheme. No dispute, but only trust scheme. If I can say it in English, no dispute, but trust scheme. Vivad Se Vishwas scheme. Sir, in the past, our government has taken several measures to reduce tax litigations. In the last budget, Sabka Vishwas scheme was brought in to reduce litigation in indirect taxes. It resulted in settling over 1,89,000 cases. Currently, there are 4,83,000 direct tax cases. 4,83,000 direct tax cases pending in various appellate forums, Commissioner of Appeals, Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, High Court, Supreme Court, and so on. This year, I propose to bring a scheme similar to the indirect tax Sabka Vishwas scheme for reducing the litigation even in the direct taxes. Under the proposed Vivad Se Vishwas scheme, a taxpayer would be required to pay only the amount of disputed tax and will get complete waiver of interest and penalty provided he pays by 31st March 2020. Those who avail this scheme after 31st March 2020 will have to pay some additional amount, but even then they can come in. The scheme will remain open till 30th June 2020. So the first thing is 31st March 2020, where you just pay the disputed tax amount, no penalty, no interest. In case you don't do it before that, you move over to 30th June, but where you pay some additional amount. Taxpayers in whose cases appeals are pending at any level can benefit from this scheme. I hope that taxpayers will make use of this opportunity to get relief from vexatious litigation process. So losses of merged banks. As part of consolidation of the financial sector, our government has brought out schemes for merger and amalgamation of public sector banks in order to ensure that amalgamated entities are able to take the benefit of unabsorbed losses and depreciation of the amalgamated entities. I propose to make necessary amendments to the provision of the Income Tax Act. Taxpayers' Charter, I mentioned it briefly in Part A. Any tax system requires trust between taxpayers and the administration. This will be possible only when taxpayers' rights are clearly enumerated. Towards this end, and with the objective of enhancing the efficiency of the delivery system of the Income Tax Department, I propose to amend the provisions of the Income Tax Act to mandate the Central Board of Direct Taxes, CBDT, to adopt a taxpayer's charter. The details of the contents of the charter will be notified soon. Instant PAN through Aadhaar. In the last budget, I had introduced the interchangeability of PAN and Aadhaar, for which necessary rules were already notified. In order to further ease the process of allotment of PAN, soon we will launch a system under which PAN shall be instantly allotted online on the basis of Aadhaar without any requirement for filling up of detailed application form. Sir, our government brought in the GST as a historic reform of the indirect taxes in 2017. We also took a path-breaking step of simplifying and rationalizing corporate tax in September 2019. More importantly, we offered a rate of corporate tax which perhaps is the lowest in the world. Continuing on this path, we have now put the personal income tax at its lowest ever rate and totally removed the DDT at the company's hands. Further, the direct taxes are now the lowest, simplest, and the smoothest. Direct tax on the startups have also been seen many reformatory steps in quick succession. Even ease of compliance is seeing unprecedented changes. Last but not the least, personal interface with tax administration is at the minimum level. So last, indirect tax. Indirect tax, sir, as I mentioned earlier in Part A of my speech, reforms are continuing in the GST. A simplified return shall be implemented from 1st April 2020. This is under the pilot run. It will make return filing simple with features like SMS-based filing for nil return, return pre-filling, improved input tax credit flow, and overall simplification. Refund process has been simplified and has been made fully automated with no human interface. Electronic invoice is another innovation wherein critical information shall be captured electronically in centralized systems. It will be implemented in a phased manner starting from this month itself on optional basis. It will facilitate compliance and return filing. Several measures have been taken for improving compliance. That has been a worry for many of the states, sir. Aadhaar-based verification of taxpayers is being introduced. This will help in weeding out dummy or non-existent unit. Dynamic QR code is proposed for consumer invoices. GST parameters will be captured when payment for purchases is made through the QR code. A system of cash reward is envisaged to incentivize customers to seek invoice. Deep data analytics and AI tools are being used for crackdown on GST input credit, input tax credit refund, and other frauds, and to identify all those who are trying to game the system. invoice and input tax credit matching is being done, wherein returns having mismatch more than 10% or above a threshold are identified and pursued. Significant policy level changes have also been made. GST rate structure is also being deliberated upon so as to address issues like inverted duty structure. Customs. A number of measures have been taken for ease of doing business. India's quantum leap in the trading across border parameter of ease of doing business rankings by the World Bank is a testimony to these efforts. India's rank on this parameter improved from 146 to 80 in 2018 and further to 68 in 2019. Measures have also been taken for providing a level playing field to our domestic manufacturers, particularly the MSME sector, and for securing our borders. It has been observed that imports under free trade agreements are on the rise. Undue claims of FTA benefits have posed threats to domestic industry. Such imports require stringent checks. In this context, suitable provisions are being incorporated in the Customs Act. In the coming months, we shall review rules of origin requirements, particularly for certain sensitive items, so as to ensure that FTAs are aligned to the conscious direction of our policy. Speaker, sir, we are also strengthening provisions relating to safeguard duties, which are applied when surge in imports causes serious injury to domestic industry. Amended provisions shall enable regulating such surge in imports in a systematic way. The provisions for checking dumping of goods and imports of subsidized goods are also being strengthened for ensuring level playing field for domestic industry. These changes are in line with international best practices. Exemptions from customs duty have been given in the public interest from time to time. However, a number of these have outlived their utility or have become outdated. On review, certain exemptions are being withdrawn. Remaining customs duty exemptions shall be comprehensively reviewed by September 2020 for taking a view on their relevance. I propose to crowdsource suggestions for such reviews. Suggestions would also be invited in respect of the customs laws and procedures for aligning them with the needs of changing times. Labor-intensive sectors in MSME are critical for employment generation. Cheap and low-quality imports are impediment to our growth. Special attention has been taken to put measured restraint on import of these items, which are being produced by our MSMEs with better quality. Keeping in view the need of the sector, customs duty is being raised on items like footwear and furniture. Our policy of Make in India has started giving dividends. Need more water. Our policy of Make in India has started giving dividends. India is now making world-class goods and exporting such products. We have made considerable progress in medical equipments too. Thank you. We have made considerable progress in medical equipment too. Till a few weeks back, we were dependent on imports for medical equipment. Now, not only we are manufacturing medical equipment, but also exporting them in large quantities. This sector deserves further fillip. Government has also been committed to provide health services to all. Ayushman Bharat has made it possible to achieve the twin objectives of giving impetus to the domestic industry.